I was initially apprehensive about Paper Mario the Origami King. From that first trailer, all I saw was more of what I already didn't like about Sticker Star and Color Splash. I got especially hesitant when we learned more information and started to see some of the early reviews. Now that the game's out and I got a chance to play through the first chapter, I'm relieved to say that Paper Mario is good, actually. Don't take this to mean that the game is perfect. It's not. There are still some flaws in the system here, but they aren't as much of a problem as they were in the previous two entries. I thought that today, I would go through and provide some of my honest thoughts about the game so far. What it got right, what it got wrong, and why that right outweighs the wrong in this particular game. We'll start with exploration. One thing that people haven't liked about the series recently, myself included, is the way that the game leans a bit too far in on the paper aesthetic. Unfortunately, that's still here, but there's a lot of things that they do with it that actually lend itself to some pretty interesting puzzle solving. Beyond that, one thing I can already tell from this game is that if you're a completionist, there's a lot for you here. The main collectible here is the toads, and I know, people didn't like how Nintendo limited intelligent systems to just toads and basic Mario enemies for its NPCs, which, again, is something that I share, but in terms of gameplay, it serves to give you a reason to search all over the place, as there might be a toad hidden in that specific corner of the world that you forgot to look at. The game also has a bunch of artifacts that you can find scattered throughout the world, which, after collecting them, can be viewed in a museum. Just like the toads, they serve to give you an incentive to explore the world more than you might otherwise if they weren't there. Of course, that's not what you're here to hear me talk about. You want to know my opinions about the combat and the story. Since I've already touched on it, I'm going to move into the whole, we're only allowed to use characters from the Mario universe, which is a restriction that Nintendo seems to be placing on secondary Mario titles now for some reason. It seems like Nintendo is trying to cultivate a very specific image for Mario, something that, for instance, having a cast of almost all original characters might potentially threaten. Unfortunately, because of that, we're stuck with Toads and Bowser's minions, which, for the most part, are just generic Mario characters, but some of them do have the occasional accessory. This is still the weakest part of the Origami King, and is easily one of its biggest pitfalls. This game would be all the better if they were just allowed to have original characters again, and maybe if they scaled back the paper gimmicks too. Like, we can have the whole thousandfold arms and filling holes with confetti thing, but perhaps we can have characters not constantly acknowledge that they're made of paper and have it just be a mechanic. All of that being said, even with those complaints, the game's world still feels more alive than it did in Sticker Star. Even with the samey characters, we still get some world building, such as getting to see a Koopa religion. We'll talk about that religion in a second, but first let's actually get into why the combat is somewhat more meaningful this time round. Get it? Time round? Okay, I'll stop. The ring-based combat system definitely does a lot to make the combat more interesting than it was in Sticker Star or Color Splash. I've already made a video on the issues with Sticker Star's combat, so I'm not really gonna harp on that too much here. You can just go watch that video instead. Link in the description and in the cards if you're interested. Returning to the Origami King, however, the main drawback is that you're not really given the freedom to get creative with your actions. There's very clearly a right answer in most battles. It may not be obvious when you first look at it, but the game makes it very evident that you do have a correct answer in every encounter. This makes it so it's less of a game about making strategic choices, as it is about thinking through each encounter and moving the enemies into the optimal position within the time limit. The biggest improvement here is the removal of disposable attacks. Sort of. There is still weapon durability in the game because, you know, it's a first-party Nintendo game on the Switch, so of course it does. Thankfully, they didn't make it apply to all weapons. Mario's basic jump and hammer attacks don't ever break. It's more so just a thing to counterbalance the stronger versions of Mario's attacks, so you still have a reason to use your basic ones. This makes it so you're at least not getting weaker with each fight, as you theoretically can beat all of them without expending any of your weapon durability. Of course, on the flip side, there is still the complaint about the lack of EXP. By looking at that, it still makes it seem like you don't have any reason to battle, but from my experience, you still do have some reason to fight, as you're able to buy accessories that make you stronger, which is something that I actually proposed in my previous video. It's not perfect, as I was still able to readily buy every piece of equipment in the game, but if you're short on coins for whatever reason, that's a pretty easy way to get them. If anything, it's good to always have a little in reserve, just in case you need to use any to buy some more time in battles, mostly in the boss fights, but in some of the random encounters as well. Speaking of boss fights, though, this is honestly one of the best aspects of the game, as of where I am in the game at least. I've fought two of them so far. The first one is actually one of the ones that I think they should have shown in the trailers, as it's considerably more interesting than the craft supplies that you fight as the main bosses. Like, guys, this is an actual original character. They managed to sneak one under the radar. This was so much more interesting than the encounter with the colored pencils, because it actually helped build the world. Honestly, they should have made this thing the boss of the first world, or at least added an origami general of some kind that controls the colored pencils, like they're a type of weapon. Even with the absurdity of fighting art supplies, though, I found the fight with the first boss to still be interesting, and it actually took me a couple of tries to figure out what exactly I was supposed to do to get past each phase. There was actual thought involved here. You needed to be able to identify what you're supposed to do in each situation in order to deal the most damage. It's not just a use the special item and win scenario. Overall, the game does quite a bit in terms of improving upon the shortcomings of its predecessors. Is it what we wanted? No, not really. I'd still rather have a more traditional Paper Mario game, but on its own, it's actually a pretty decent game. Many of the design flaws are less pronounced and are handled in such a way that unless you're looking for them, you'd be unlikely to notice. Anyways, if you found this video to be an enjoyable experience, be sure to like, comment, and all of that jazz. The only thing that I ask is be respectful of other people's opinions in the comments. If you want more, make sure to subscribe so you don't miss when I upload my next video. In the meantime, though, you can check out my analysis video on Pokemon Mystery Dungeon or the one about Sticker Star that I mentioned earlier. But until next time, guys, peace!